Hi folks, this is David Kwan here. So there are, I guess, three things I want to just say about the election results that happened this past Tuesday. So there was the midterm elections, a lot of the races for senators, for congressmen, local comptrollers, governors, things like that. So that's what the midterm election results are. We already know the results of what happened. So I just want to make a few quick comments here and there about it. One of the really interesting thing, the first interesting thing is that, so Republicans, politicians-wise, you know, had a major victory in this midterm election. So a lot of the people voted in were, you know, Republicans. Now Republicans have a majority in the House of Representatives and in the Senate. So they have a majority now, or they're going to have, after January, majority in Congress. So that's going to be very interesting. But what's also kind of contrast to that is the ballot measures, right? So there were a couple of ballots that were ballot measures and amendments that people voted for, and those actually tended to be more, the results ended up being more in favor of Democrats and progressives. You know, marijuana was legalized in Oregon. It's now decriminalized in Washington, D.C., and the little stuff that in New York, you know, that was a result of the whole redistricting thing didn't happen. In California, the sentencing was reduced for people with nonviolent offenses. It's a small step in that state, but nonetheless, it's a move towards criminal justice reform. Hopefully that trend keeps on happening, because California is one where we drastically need that. That's a state still with the three strikes law, and a state still where a lot of the prisons are the worst abusers of enforcing solitary confinement. There's people in the Pelican Bay prison where somebody has been in solitary confinement for 29 years or something like that, with, you know, an average of 23 hours per day of those 29 years, which is crazy. But that's an interesting kind of contrast, where the policies that people voted for are progressive and liberal and proposed and favored by Democrats. But the people who won the office, the people who get to make policies now after January, are Republicans. So that is a very interesting contrast that I thought was good to point out. So that brings me to my second point, which is this election had a very low voter turnout, but usually midterm elections in America, or elections in general in America, have very low voter turnout. So we Americans like to, you know, United States of America likes to boast that it's the most democratic country in the world, whereas majority of people don't exercise their right to vote. So that's an interesting thing about America. Even in presidential elections, the most we get is like 50% or 55% of people voting. You know, in contrast to some other countries like India, which has recently had its presidential election, like 80% of the population voted. So that's a huge contrast. But in midterm elections, it's even worse in America. People just don't vote. So that's also really interesting. I think the election results would have been very different if everybody who could vote in America voted. I wonder what that would have looked like. And it's, like I said in another brief video about kind of my first experience in voting in New York, not a lot of the information about who the candidates are, what they stand for, what the ballots are like, kind of get out there. Also, in regards to my first point about the policies being voted in progressive and the politicians that got voted in being Republicans, one of the things I think is interesting is when I was on there in the polling station and I looked at the options, the candidates that are on there, I ended up really kind of voting down by the party they represented, although I knew who they were. But that's kind of what happens when you vote for people. It's like, oh, he's a Democrat. Oh, he's a Green. He's an independent. He's working families. He's a Republican. He's a Libertarian. So you kind of vote down by the party line. So that ends up happening. The ballots, it's very hard to say no, to vote no, without knowing what they are, because they sound so good. In New York, there were three ballot measures, right? So one is about creating this commission that will every 10 years redistrict the voting zones to make it fair and non-discriminatory and things like that. It sounds so good. But until you realize more about it, like, you can't really determine whether this is something you should say no to or not. There was a ballot measure that was like, oh, we should have state bonds. We should sell $2 billion of those of state bonds and use that money to fund technology and education in New York City public schools or New York State public schools. Sounds so great. Sounds so awesome. So it's very hard to vote no, I think, on the ballot measures unless you know exactly what the ballot measure is. So something like marijuana legalization, everybody knows it. So everyone kind of already had their opinion on it, and they can either vote no or yes depending on what they know, which is what happened. In Oregon, they voted yes to marijuana legalization. In Florida, they voted no. They knew exactly what they were voting for, so they got to vote that way. But the ballot measures, when you see that on paper, it's just like, it's so easy to vote yes and very hard to vote no because it sounds so good, you know? So that's one thing. Another thing is, so the last thing, the final thing, the third thing that I want to say is regarding this election, Republicans had a story. You know, they had this, they were able to sell to the public, hey, we have Obama, a Democrat, as a president, and Obama is a horrible president, he's ruining our country, you don't want, you know, another Obama supporter in office, do you? Well, vote for us instead. So they kind of, also they did a lot of fear-mongering. If you continue to have Obama as a president, then we're going to have Ebola in this country, we're going to have terrorists attack our country, ISIS is going to spread, America is in danger. So all those kind of things, very fear-driven campaign, well, you know, regardless of whether it's factual or not, Republicans had a powerful story. They were able to get their propaganda set up right across. They had a powerful story. The Democrats, on the other hand, didn't really have a story to tell. You know, they could have had a story. They could have had a story of Obamacare is working. You know, under President Obama, economy has grown. Unemployment has decreased. The debt has gone down by $1 trillion. They had an opportunity to tell their stories. They didn't. A lot of the candidates, the one thing they did was, oh, I don't support Obama. They distanced themselves away from the president of their party, to almost be like, are you a Democrat or are you a wannabe Democrat who sounds more like a Republican? So when people got to vote, when they get this message, you know, why not have the real thing rather than a pretend Republican thing? Which is, I think, one of the reasons why Republicans had a strong kind of support. And also the disillusionment. When people who are registered Democrats see this, the Democrats kind of distancing themselves away. Do you want to vote for a Democrat who doesn't act like a Democrat? No. So what ends up happening is people who would want to vote for Democrats, they don't vote at all. So because either parties, you know, if both parties are bad and, you know, the third parties have no chance of winning, then why vote, right? So that explains kind of low voter turnout. And because the conservative people, the Republican people, I think, like I said, I think they have a more kind of this better sense of civic duty. They tend to be white Americans. They tend to be, you know, great majority of them are male. And great majority of them happen to be older and married. You know, just going by kind of statistical analysis, not every Republican is this picture. You know, there are black, woman, Latina, Republican voters, of course, but I'm saying, like, as a full picture, you know, the typical Republican voter is white, married, older, so they tend to have more this kind of sense of patriotism, like, we gotta vote, we gotta make sure to vote, so they have that, you know, and so when Republicans are able to tell their stories more powerfully, of course they're gonna go out there and vote, but if you're on a boat for a Democrat or a progressive, like a Green or even Libertarian, I don't know, whatever you want to vote for, or there might even be a Socialist Party or a Working Family candidate on some of the ballots. You want to go out there and vote, and it's just like, oh, I don't really know what they stand for. They're distancing themselves from their own message, their own beliefs. They kind of you no longer really want to boat. It kind of knocks down that motive to boat. So of course they're not going to boat. So of course we have the results that we have. So we have a result in which the policies that were voted for are very progressive, are, you know, would favor more Democrats than Republicans. But the people that were voted in to make those policies and to make more laws ended up being Republicans. So those are the three interesting things I wanted to kind of point out about this year's midterm elections. And I feel like this happens with pretty much every midterm year election. You know, I think President Clinton had this problem as well, where one of the terms, it was just the Republican majority Congress, and he was like the Democratic president. So, yeah, what this actually means, I'm not a political pundit, so I'm not going to comment on that, but these are just some of the opinions that I thought to brought out. These are some of my thoughts about the elections, because I actually got to vote this year for the first time ever, so these were just my thoughts. If you guys enjoyed, cheers.